Welcome to the class 5 of Instrumental Methods of Biomedical Analysis. Today's topic is NMR spectroscopy, part 1. In the previous class, we discussed about absorption spectroscopy, that is UV visible spectroscopy, where electronic transition takes place. The second method is IR spectroscopy, where vibrational energy or vibrational transition takes place. The third method of absorption spectroscopy is nuclear magnetic resonance, that is NMR spectroscopy, because the nuclei of the atom surrounded by subatoms, that is electron, proton and neutron. When these subatoms absorbs energy in the electromagnetic radiation, that is in the radio frequency region, they absorbs energy and spins around their own axis. That is called as nuclear magnetic resonance, that is rotation is going to be takes place. It means the molecule, apart from electronic and vibrational energy, they are having rotational energy also. You can see in the electromagnetic radiation, that is UV visible spectroscopy is having a electronic transitions, infrared is vibrational transitions, and microwave and radio frequency, when a molecule if it absorbs, the rotational energy takes place. Now NMR spectroscopy is the study of spin changes at nuclear level. When radio frequency energy is absorbed in the presence of magnetic field, when a molecule is kept in a higher magnetic field and radio frequency, that is the energy if it is applied, and they starts the change in the spin, means rotation is going to be start, and with this rotation we can identify the structure of the molecule. Sometimes this NMR spectroscopy is also called as proton magnetic resonance, that is hydrogen, that is proton, is studied, and it is also called as 1H NMR, and other nuclei also, it is carbon NMR, that is C13 NMR, fluorine F19 NMR, and chlorine Cl35 NMR. Generally speaking, hydrogen or proton spectroscopy itself, it is called as NMR spectroscopy. Now the NMR phenomena is based on the fact that nuclei of some atoms have a property is called spin, that is rotate, and these nuclei behaves as a spin magnet. Why it is called magnet? Because the spin property of electron will have two spins, that is plus half and minus half. Now the each spin active nucleus has a number of spin is called as spin quantum number, that is I. The odd mass number, that is 1 by 2, 3 by 2 or 5 by 2, that is 1 hydrogen, 13 carbon, 19 fluorine and 35 chlorine, only gives the information, and they are having a spin number 1, that is plus half and minus half. The even mass number atoms will not active in NMR, that is carbon 12, oxygen 16 and sulfur 32, they are inactive in the NMR spectroscopy because their spins are paired and cancel each other. Either they are having plus half or plus half or minus half and minus half, so they both cancel themselves, so that's why they are inactive. Only one hydrogen, 13 carbon or carbon 13, 19 fluorine and 35 Cl, that is 1 by 2, 3 by 2 and 5 by 2 will give the spin quantum number 1 will be active in NMR spectroscopy. The principle of NMR spectroscopy is based on that any proton or nucleus with odd mass number spin on its own axis when an external magnetic field, if it is applied, a nucleus is spin on its own axis and they generate a magnetic moment which is called as precessional orbit with some frequency called precessional frequency, and this state is called as ground state or parallel orientation. Because the odd mass number, that is hydrogen 1, carbon 13, fluorine 19 and chlorine 35, they are having their own precessional orbit which is called as precessional frequency, and they are in the ground state and in the parallel orientation. In this state, the magnetic field caused by the spin of the nuclei is aligned with the external magnetic field applied. So when the energy in the form of radio frequency, that is 9 to 900 meter hertz, that frequency of energy if it is applied, and when applied frequency is equal to precessional frequency, absorption of energy of the atom will take place and NMR signal is recorded. So this is the mu, that is plus half and minus half, that is the two spin. These two states of spin are equivalent in energy in the absence of the magnetic field, means they are aligned. When an external magnetic field, if it is applied, they will jump from higher energy state to the lower energy state and you will get the NMR peaks. When the nucleus absorbs the energy in the radio frequency region, the nucleus will move from ground state to the excited state. In the previous slides you have seen that they are arranged in the parallel orientation with their own some magnetic properties, that is plus half and minus half rotation. Now when the atom absorbs the energy in the form of a radio frequency region, and when it is applied by a magnetic field, they will jump from one energy state to the another energy state. Plus half will be jumps and it comes down in the opposite direction. It means that when the molecule or the nucleus absorb the radio frequency energy, it will jumps from one state to the another state, that is from the ground state to the excited state, which results in the spin reversal. The plus half will be changes to minus half and minus half will be changes to the plus half. That is called as anti-parallel orientation, because as such the molecules, they are having some magnetic property, they will aligned in the parallel orientation. When the external magnetic field which is applied, when it is higher, then they will jump and immediately they will comes down, which is called as anti-parallel orientation. And the spin of the nucleus opposes, it's called align against or unaligned. In the figure you can see that is unaligned and the aligned position, that is in the opposite direction. The atoms will jumps and immediately it will comes down. This is the energy separation, that is degenerated at BO is zero, that is BO is nothing but the magnetic field, that is in parallel direction, that is arranged in a parallel orientation. When the magnetic field strength is increases, they will jumps and comes down, and you will get the signal of the NMR. This is the aligned and unaligned diagram. When an atom absorbs energy, when the magnetic field is increases, that plus of will changes to minus of, that is opposed, that is anti-parallel, and it immediately comes down, that is to plus half. So they are aligned in plus half, they will goes to the anti-parallel direction or oppose, then immediately comes down to the normal position, that is plus half. And this is when an atom kept, the molecules containing the atoms which is kept in a higher magnetic field, that poles of magnet north and south pole, and energy that is from 440 to 600 megahertz if it is applied in the form of energy, and this is the precessional frequency, this is the precessional energy or orbit we can see, and that is in the plus half, and above it is minus half, that is in opposite direction. Now the point is to be noted here is why radio frequency radiation and external magnetic field is very important in NMR spectra. Means when the strength of the magnetic field, if it is increases, it does not causes the transitions, that is from ground state to the excited state, and the merely increases the precessional frequency. Without application of magnetic field, there is no spin state and there is only one average spin. Hence radio frequency radiation in the form of energy as well as magnetic field is required in NMR spectroscopy. Now coming to the instrumentation of NMR spectroscopy, there are two general types of NMR spectrometers will be used, that is CW NMR spectrometer, that is continuous wave, and second one is FT NMR, that is Fourier transform. The CW NMR, that is continuous spectrometer, NMR spectrometer is the older type, and it is similar to the principle of operation, depends on the optical scan spectrometer. Here the sample is held in a strong magnetic field and the frequency of the source is slowly scanned. In some instrument the radio frequency will be kept constant, that is 60 megahertz, and the magnetic field will be scanned. In both the cases different nuclei absorb the electromagnetic radiation in the radio frequency region by the chemical environment and produces the NMR signals, which is called as NMR spectra. This is the NMR spectrometer. It consists of two magnetic poles. In between, a sample in a test tube will be kept, and it contains radio frequency transmitter, that is called as RF transmitter, which is used to apply the radio frequency radiations from 60 megahertz to 400 megahertz depending on the capacity or resolution of the instrument. There is a RF receiver is connected to the sample itself to receive the radio frequency and amplifies that, convert into the electric current and amplifies, and it is connected to the recorder. And the sample test tubes, which is about 25 centimeter long and 5 mm outer diameter, is kept inside the sample cavity and is spun at 30 rounds per second to get the uniformity of the sample.
Now the sample is dissolved in a solvent containing no interfering protons, means the sample will be dissolved in an appropriate solvent. So that solvent should not contain any proton. It means it should not contain a hydrogen, because it is PMR, that is only hydrogen will be calculated. In usual practice, carbon tetrachloride is a solvent that does not contain any hydrogen, that is CCl4, or sometimes CdCl3. Instead of chloroform, that hydrogen will be deteriorated, that is CdCl3 will be used to dissolve the sample. And a small amount of TMS, that is tetramethylsilane. So this tetramethylsilane contains 12 carbon, we will get the peak at the zero level, that is at 0 μm, you are going to be get a peak. That peak will be matched with the, or counted with the sample protons. And the TMS will be served as a internal reference standard. The sample will be filled in the glass tube that is suspended in a gap between the faces of the two poles of the magnet. And the sample is spun, or it will be mixed to rotate in its axis to ensure that all parts of the solution get the uniform magnetic field. And also a magnet gap is in a coil attached to a 60 megahertz frequency with the radio frequency generator. Now the coil supplies the electromagnetic energy. When the sample absorbs energy, the reorientation is going to be takes place. When the sample does not absorb energy, no peaks will be detected by the detector. When the sample absorbs energy, the reorientation of the nuclear spin induces a radio frequency signal that will be detected by the detector, and we will get the peaks or signals. In most of the sophisticated instrument like FT-NMR, that is Fourier Transfer NMR, just 1 to 2 second we will get the peaks, which is called as pulse. Here a short burst of energy will be given for seconds to excite the all magnetic nuclei in the molecule simultaneously. And the energy is given, that is 90 megahertz, it will be given for just 1 to 10 seconds. And the proton nuclei induces to undergo resonance at the same time. When the pulse is discontinued, the excited nuclei begin to lose their excitation energy and returns to the original spin state. This is called as relaxation period. As such, excited nucleus relax, it emits electromagnetic radiation. Many different frequency of electromagnetic radiation are emitted simultaneously. This emission is called FID, that is free induction decay. So this pulses of many pulses, that is FID, will be calculated by the use of computer, and mathematically it will be converted into peaks. So that's why it is called as Fourier transform. That pulse will be transferred into the peaks. So this is what we discussed. So these are the FID pulse. In the right hand side you can see, and in the left side a single pulse with a frequency can be calculated. It is transformed. That is called Fourier transform. Here the sample is placed in a constant, that is in a usual strong magnetic field, and it is irradiated for the short period of time, that is 1 to 10 seconds we will get the pulse. The resulting signals containing information about the nuclei, that is of proton, and the signals will be converted into the spectrum, which is called as Fourier transform. That FT-NMR allows signal averaging, which leads to enhancement of the real spectral signal versus noise. So these are the advantages of FT-NMR over CW-NMR spectrometer, that is continuous wave method spectrometer. So this it is most sensitive if you are comparing to the CW, that is continuous wave method. So in continuous wave method, gives 5 to 10 minutes is required to scan and record the CW spectrum. But in the pulse, it is much faster and measures as an FID, that is free induction decay, and can be performed in the few seconds with the help of a computer and fast measurement. And in this FT NMR, it is possible to repeat the average measure of FID signals. Just in 2 seconds, one more pulse, 3 seconds, one more pulse can be taken and it can be transformed. For some NMR spectrophotometer, superconducting magnet that is having a stronger magnetic field, that is 600 megahertz, can also be used. Thank you so much.